is a registered dietitian, and she's an assistant professor in our Department of Food Science and Human Nutrition. And she's the director of the Functional Foods and Human Health Laboratory in our department. Her research focuses on critically examining the efficacy and mechanisms by which nutritional interventions, primarily functional foods, improve risk factors for cardiovascular disease in high-risk aging populations, with a special interest in postmenopausal women. How is that? There's a lot more. She has tons of publications and tons of awards, and she has promised to post this bio on our website. She also has her cards up here, so after she's done presenting, if you'd like to come and talk to her or grab her card, you can do that. So with no further ado, I will introduce Sarah.
Wonderful introduction, and I tend to not speak very loud, so if you guys can't hear me, please feel free to let me know at any time to speak louder. And thank you all for coming to listen to this talk today. So I am going to talk about functional foods with respect to cardiovascular health. Just some objectives of the study. I hope that you guys can see this okay. Basically, at the end of this presentation, you should be able to just sort of generally define what functional foods are, describe evidence supporting the role, well, I guess this pointer is going to work, but supporting the role of functional foods and their bioactive components in cardiovascular health. You should be able to provide some evidence-based information for your patients and clients, if any of you are practitioners, but if not, you can provide the recommendations for yourself. And you should be able to discuss functional foods that can improve cardiovascular health in the context of different populations and what are the factors that influence the variability in responses to these foods, as well as ways to incorporate them into your diet. So I'm sure many of you are already well aware of this, but chronic diseases and conditions in the United States are pretty prevalent. Most people in the United States actually, actually 7 out of the 10 leading causes of death in the United States are chronic diseases or conditions. And as of 2012, about half of all adults had one or more chronic diseases or conditions. 1 in 4 adults had 2 or more, so obviously pretty prevalent, and some people have even greater than and in 2010, 86% of all of the healthcare costs that were spent were attributed to chronic diseases and conditions. So obviously this is a problem. A lot of these chronic diseases and conditions can be attenuated or prevented, so it's definitely something to look into a little bit more. So what causes chronic diseases? Well, we have these non-modifiable risk factors such as aging. We can't control getting older, unfortunately. We haven't come up with a cure for aging just yet. Genetic predisposition and sex, not gender, sex is a non-modifiable risk factor. But there are these modifiable risk factors such as smoking, or excessive alcohol consumption, poor diet, physical activity, and hopefully this picture of, has anyone here seen Wally? Hopefully that's not truly what our future looks like, but anyways, good point. So usually these risk factors are going to be expressed through some sort of intermediate risk factor, so something that we can measure. So this can include elevated blood pressure, increased blood glucose levels, abnormal lipids, overweight, obesity, etc. So those are sort of signals that we might be at a greater risk of developing chronic diseases. And we have sort of this web of chronic disease. So a lot of these risk factors are not just risk factors for one chronic disease or condition, but actually sort of intermingle, I guess you could say, in this web, and can contribute to numerous chronic diseases, such as cardiovascular disease, cancer, diabetes, et cetera. And some processes that are sort of underlying these disease states are oxidative stress and inflammation that sort of work in a bi-directional relationship to contribute to chronic disease. Does everyone here know what oxidative stress is? Have you heard of an antioxidant? All right, so we have these free radicals in our body. They're normal. They're supposed to be in there, but sometimes they sort of get out of control. So we have more free radicals than we should and not enough antioxidants to quench them. So this is what we call oxidative stress. And these free radicals basically are looking for something in the body to react with. They want to pair up with something. And usually they're going to find something to pair in our cells and our tissues, so they can cause damage to our DNA, for example, damage to our cells, and this can contribute to chronic disease. Inflammation is also a normal physiological process. When you cut yourself, you have sort of redness there. It might become a little bit warm. You have pus. I know that sounds gross. Sorry, you're all human. But those are normal things that are supposed to happen to help you heal. But when this is long-term and sustained, it's not normal. And so that can contribute to chronic disease. So in the United States, we have several leading causes of death, many of which, as I said, are chronic diseases and conditions. Cardiovascular disease is the number one leading cause of death, pretty quickly followed by cancer. And so basically, cardiovascular disease has traditionally been thought of as a disease of aging. It's something that sort of naturally, as you could say, happens with aging. You can see the prevalence increases as you get older, and men are typically at a greater risk than women until women undergo menopause. So they're sort of protected before they hit menopause, and then after menopause, their risk increases to match men and sometimes exceeds their risk. So hopefully you guys can read this diagram, but basically, just very simply, with aging, something that occurs naturally is a vascular aging. So our vasculature becomes more stiff, becomes more rigid. The cells that sort of produce molecules within your blood vessel to cause your blood vessel to expand and contract, it sort of buffers blood flow. This is what's supposed to happen. This becomes dysfunctional naturally as we get older. These are referred to as endothelial dysfunction and arterial stiffness. Those are natural. However, certain processes and risk factors such as hypertension, abnormal lipid levels, diabetes, overweight, obesity, etc., can accelerate this vascular aging, increasing our risk for developing cardiovascular disease. So once we have these processes that become accelerated, we get plaque formation in our arteries called atherosclerosis. We can develop hypertension if we didn't have it already, sort of this self-perpetuating cycle. So the work that we do in our lab sort of is trying to target some of these intermediate risk factors for the development of chronic disease, because I can't do a clinical intervention study with a population and follow you until you eventually pass away. It's a little morbid, but I can't do that. But I can look at your vascular function, I can look at these risk factors, I can try to improve these. They're called surrogate markers. So it kind of helps me to get an idea of whether this intervention can protect you against developing cardiovascular disease. There are numerous risk factors for cardiovascular disease. A lot of these are the same as what I previously said, but high blood pressure, high blood cholesterol, diabetes, smoking, heavy alcohol abuse, being physically inactive, an unhealthy diet. These are all modifiable risk factors. So with respect to diet, and I think a lot of you probably work with patients or you're learning about it, or you just see this in your day-to-day life. But basically, recently for the dietary guidelines that recently came out last couple of years, they showed that the majority of the U.S. population is not meeting the U.S. dietary guidelines. And it's especially true for vegetables and fruits. So the side on the blue side shows you where people either meet the needs that are either taking in enough or not enough, if that makes sense. So with vegetables, less than 20% of the population meets the recommendations here. For fruits, it's a little bit over 20. Grains, definitely doing better. Dairy, not enough. And then over here in orange, it shows you how many people are not having enough. So definitely quite a lot. But we sure are getting plenty of sodium and saturated fats, added sugars. So those are the things that we need, I guess. So the research that we do that I'm interested in, like I said, is how can we sort of prevent or manage some of these risk factors that can increase our risk? Well, we know that a lot of these can be prevented, managed, or treated through lifestyle approaches. One obvious one is exercise. We all know exercise is good for you, right? Diet as well. So this can include a healthy eating pattern. And there are numerous healthy eating patterns that exist. The three most evidence-based patterns include the healthy U.S. style eating pattern, which is sort of recommends foods within the dietary guidelines. There's the dietary approaches to stop hypertension diet or the DASH diet. And there's also the Mediterranean dietary pattern, which probably most of you have heard of as some of you. Not sure if you can see this, but basically just showing you how the DASH and the Mediterranean diet compare. Basically, the common denominators, the common themes in these diets is that they're very focused on plant foods. So eating fruits, vegetables, whole grains, having lean meats, low-fat dairy or non-fat dairy, plenty of beans, nuts, legumes, and eliminating your fats and sweets and oils other than olive oil, specifically for the Mediterranean diet. So I took this from the dietary guidelines. I like this. So empower people to make healthy shifts. Making changes to eating patterns can be overwhelming. That is definitely true. That's why it's important to emphasize that every food choice is an opportunity to move toward a healthy eating pattern. Small shifts in food choices over the course of a week, a day, or even a meal can make a big difference. So, and I'm a registered dietitian. I used to practice. Right now I practice on my husband, who like loves chicken wings, and sometimes he's like, I'm going to go vegetarian. I'm like, okay, let's go in the middle, you know, small, it doesn't have to be one or the other, and that's very true. So when you think about making a dietary change, if you think about it in the context of, all right, I got to like change my whole diet, I'm going to get new food, I'm going to the grocery store, that can be really overwhelming and hard to sustain. But if you start with small choices, that's a lot easier. It's doable. I'm eating lunch right now. Maybe I'll replace this for a salad or something like that. You know, little things, not everything at once. So examples of this include switching out high-calorie snacks for nutrient-dense foods, substituting fruit products with added sugars for whole fruit, whole grains instead of refined grains, oils instead of solid fats, no sugar-added beverages instead of those. So one thing I've always heard, well, not in those exact words, but what's in it for me. Especially when you're young and healthy, you don't really see the immediate benefit of making dietary changes, right? You don't see that it's going to lower your blood cholesterol because your cholesterol is high. So we know that shifting our overall dietary patterns away from these nutrient-dense traditional foods that we're used to, more nutrient-dense options can support a healthy body weight. It can help you to meet your nutrition needs. So you may have a deficiency in vitamin D and just not know what to do because you don't feel it yet. Lessen the risk of chronic disease, such as cardiovascular disease. And one way that I like to think about this is you have to pay sometime. It's like a credit card. You can either put it on your credit card and pay later, or you can pay now and not pay later. So when I think about foods and the foods that I want to put in my body, I like to pay more now in terms of money, obviously, but just more work instead of paying later. This one's my favorite. But it's so expensive. It's expensive to eat healthy, and sometimes it can be, but we have to take a step back. So I think And I love coffee. I'm not putting down coffee. How many of you guys like to drink your coffee? Like to buy coffee out. I love that too. But a lot of people see coffee as definitely affordable. You buy it every day. Absolutely need it. Can't live without it. This can cost anywhere from $3 to probably some can be like $10. I bet if you add your espresso shots and all this fancy stuff. And the calories, if you get like non-fat, sugar-free, can be 60 calories, or it can be over 600, probably like 800 calories. Blueberries, too expensive, an occasional treat. Depending on the season, can cost anywhere from $2 to $5. Calories are only 85. You know, so I think if we sort of prioritize and think about what's affordable, we can make room for this too. So a central theme of these healthy dietary patterns, as I said, includes the fact that they're rich in plant foods, such as fruits and vegetables. Certain foods, which I'll get into what functional foods are, can exert very specific functional properties. And I think that understanding the health benefits of specific foods not only can advance our understanding and sort of help us come up with better nutritional interventions and medical treatments, but it can also encourage their consumption. So if you know that something can be good for your vasculature, maybe you're more willing to consume it than if you didn't know, or if it promotes brain health, right? So what is a functional food? Has anyone here heard of a functional food before? Has anyone not heard of a functional food? So basically in the United States, there's actually no clear definition of what a functional food is. The United States Food and Drug Administration, or the FDA, is essentially there to protect public health by ensuring safety, efficacy, security of human drugs, biological products, etc. But the FDA doesn't have a statutory definition of functional foods, and therefore they do not regulate functional foods. They do, however, regulate any claims that are associated with food. So if you see soy protein on the package, that it may protect against coronary heart disease, that's an FDA-approved health claim. They regulate that. So if you make a false claim, Palm Wonderful a couple years ago had some pretty interesting health claims. Basically, it could cure everything. Kind Cars, I believe, had one as well. There are a few companies, for various reasons, that have put out non-approved health claims, so the FDA will come after you. So, there are numerous organizations that do define functional foods. So one of them is the National Academy of Sciences, and they define this as any modified food or food ingredient that may provide a health benefit beyond that of the traditional nutrients that it contains. The Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics defines this as whole foods along with fortified, enriched, or enhanced foods that have a potentially beneficial effect on health when consumed as part of a varied diet on a regular basis, at effective levels, based on significant standards of evidence. That is a loaded definition. So basically, that's a very specific one. And they have protected themselves with that one. But they support FDA-approved health claims. They also acknowledge that basically any food can be functional on some level, but certain foods have compounds that are not the traditional nutrients that we think of that can have these additional functional properties, and I'll get into that a little bit more in a minute. The Institute of Food Technologists defines functional foods as foods and food components that provide a health benefit beyond basic nutrition for the intended population. And they include numerous foods in here, such as conventional, fortified, enriched, enhanced foods, dietary supplements, etc. And then the International Life Sciences of North America has their own foods that by virtue of physiologically active food components provide health benefits beyond basic nutrition. So the theme of these definitions is that it's a food that contains bioactive components that provides a health benefit beyond basic nutrition. So every food can be functional. Sugar can be functional. That doesn't mean that it provides a health benefit beyond basic nutrition. So the foods that you're eating right now, lettuce, for example, what makes it this green color? It has some plant compounds that contribute to the green color. Those are what we think of as these non-traditional nutrients called phytochemicals. The traditional nutrients are more like vitamins, minerals, stuff that you absolutely need to live. Those are more required, traditional in that sense. Polyphenols, phytochemicals, not required, but definitely have health benefits. And functional foods, there are so many different kinds. So we can have everything from your basic whole foods, such as blueberries, legumes, green leafy vegetables. We can have dried fruit, so those are dried plums up there. We have juices, so I'm actually studying bean juice right now. That's a processed form of a functional food. Tea, something that's fermented. Beet chips, not sure if that's quite a functional food. They call it a superfood, which I will get into that later. And then there are all of these other, so like calcium-fortified orange juice is technically considered a functional food because they've modified the components that it contains to have a functional effect, which is to enhance bone health. Plant cereals added to butter, omega-3 enriched eggs, etc. So these bioactive food components, what are they exactly? And when I talk about these today, I'm talking mostly in the context of plant foods, but these do exist in dairy and other foods as well. So these contain essential and non-essential compounds, so essential being vitamins and minerals, things that you need to live. Non-essential compounds include polyphenols, which I'll talk about. So these compounds are synthesized by plants for their normal plant functions, such as photosynthesis, respiration, and growth. They also provide some protection against infection and predators. So they're really synthesized for the plants to live, to grow, to flourish, to not be eaten by insects. And they can actually have some of the same effects within our body. Beta-carotene, for example, is good for helping to protect plants against the sun. Well, it actually helps you to protect your skin against the sun. They may contribute to color, flavor, and aroma. And they've also been shown to exert biological effects in humans. So that means that they're able to interact at the cellular level, the tissue level, the organ level, and sort of either enhance or potentially impair, depending the function, the normal function of our body. And a lot of these are being shown to have health-promoting and disease-preventive effects. So as I mentioned, all foods are functional on some level, but others may have very specific functional, intermediate, and or long-term effects. But there are a lot of factors that can influence functional effects of these foods in the body. So it's not just as simple as blueberries are good for you, everybody can eat them, it's going to exert the same effect no matter what. I wish it was vegetable, but it's not. Actually, I don't, so I would put it in research. So there are environmental factors such as the influence of the farm to table continuum. So everything from planting the food to harvesting it to processing it, transporting and those factors, the types and amounts of compounds that are within the foods, the quantity consumed, so you can't have two blueberries versus a cup and expect the same results. And I'm always going to use blueberries as an example. I apologize. Factors influencing digestion, absorption, and metabolism, your duration of exposure, so how long are you consuming this food for, as well as your baseline physiological state. Are you a young, healthy person? Are you an older, healthy person? Are you a type 2 diabetic? All of these factors can actually influence how you respond to these foods. So when we think about the farm-to-table continuum, we have pre-harvest over here, which can include genotype, so that affects the specific phenotype, or sort of the colors, the variety, the flavor, etc. Soil type, climate, so something that's grown in Colorado versus something that's grown in Africa may be totally different. harvesting, so maturity at harvest, harvesting methods, post-harvest, transportation. So some things are transported from the farm here to your house. Some things are transported from Mexico to here in the wintertime when something's not in season. How was it harvested? Storage time and conditions. So certain foods can be stored for months. Ripening hormones, radiation, canning, dehydration, freezing, juicing, pasteurization. There are all of these factors, and I'm not saying that they're bad, because actually some of these, such as fermentation, can enhance the functional properties of foods. Juicing sometimes can release certain compounds that might be hard for your body to sort of extract from the food in general. And then there's consumer practices. So how do you select your foods, and what do you do with them when you get home? How are they stored? How are they prepared? These are all contributing factors. So an example, genotype is actually reported to account for between 40 and 92% of the variation in the content and the composition of bioactive compounds in plants. And here's a good example. Have you guys seen purple potatoes, red potatoes? And actually some purple potatoes aren't colored all the way through. So when it's sort of localized to the skin, then the compounds are only in the skin, whereas if it's colored all the way through, the compounds are all the way through the potato. Same thing with apples. We have green apples, red apples, yellow apples, probably some guys. Broccoli is an example. So when you buy frozen broccoli, it's actually been blanched prior to freezing. And that helps to preserve it and sort of extend the shelf life. But blanching actually inactivates a very specific enzyme that converts one of the bioactive compounds into its active form, so potentially reducing the bioavailability and efficacy there. Cooking and processing tomatoes releases lycopenes. The lycopene is a biochemical that gives it sort of its red color. So this actually releases it from the cell matrix and makes it into a more bioavailable form. If you add olive oil or any kind of fat to it, it actually helps you to absorb it better. Interestingly, watermelons have very bioavailable lycopene, so you can just eat that fresh. So in order for something to be bioavailable, bioavailability just quickly means that you're able to take the compounds out of the foods that you contain, absorb it, metabolize it, and eliminate it. It means to basically get into your body, get to the tissues that you need to get to exert the effects, and be eliminated when it needs to be. If it can't do that, then it can't have its health effects. Numerous factors can influence bioavailability, such as how you consume the food, so eating a fresh tomato versus a cooked one, the molecular structures, etc. I'm not going to get into the details there. But basically, like I said, in order to exert its effects, it needs to come out of the food matrix, get into your digestive tract, be metabolized, absorbed, and reach the tissue of action. So, and this is just showing you how complex this is. So we start with dietary polyphenols. And polyphenols, I'm not going to get into the chemistry here, I don't want to bore you with that. But basically, it's this very specific structure. So polyphenols can be as simple as having like one of those phenolic rings, or it can have multiple of these rings bound together to other compounds and attached to sugars and all sorts of things. And so your body basically has to be able to break that down in order to get it into your bloodstream. It's sort of like a medication. You know, your body's trying to protect you from having toxic effects from these compounds. So some are able to be absorbed directly from your small intestine, go to the liver, but some have to go to your colon, where the bacteria there help to metabolize the compounds, so that it can then be absorbed, go to the liver, eventually make it to the tissues. Some of it will be metabolized and excreted in the kidney, urine, and so they can be eliminated through urine and feces. And I'm sure if you all have eaten beets before, you've seen it dye some things red. So So that's an example of that. So some of it's been absorbed, but some of it also passes through. So there is definitely variability in metabolism of bioactive compounds. So some of those have genetic mutations that influence how we metabolize certain compounds. We all have different microbiota. So microbiota in the gut is these beneficial and sometimes harmful bacteria there that sort of help us to extract certain nutrients. There's also the dietary context of which it was ingested, and certain disease states can potentially alter this as well. So specific effects in the body that bioactive compounds can have. So as I mentioned, free radicals, excessive free radicals can lead to oxidative stress. So these compounds within fruits and vegetables can serve as antioxidants and directly scavenge these molecules. They can also interact with antioxidant enzymes as well as the factors in our body that produce these antioxidant enzymes that we have in each of us right now to sort of enhance their activity. They can inhibit the absorption of certain nutrients during digestion, so it could be that it's inhibiting or slowing the absorption of glucose, which can be a good thing sometimes, right? We can increase enzyme activity, it can interfere with enzyme activity, it can mimic certain signaling molecules such as estrogen, they can serve as diuretics. So different foods, depending on the compounds they contain, have different effects in the body. So I obviously, for the sake of time, can't go over every functional food that has cardiovascular health benefits, but what I do kind of want to do is give you an introduction to a few foods and show you some differences in responses and sort of what might be contributing to that. So soy protein is one of the foods that has an FDA-approved health claim that's very specific to soy protein and coronary heart disease. And so research, this is based on tons of scientific evidence, and they concluded that soy protein included in a diet low in saturated fat and cholesterol may reduce the risk of coronary heart disease by lowering blood cholesterol levels by 2-7%. And this includes total cholesterol and your bad LDL cholesterol. But this requires you to eat a total of, or a minimum of 25 grams of soy protein per day, which is sort of a lot. It could be half of your protein, depending on what your protein is. It's hypothesized that some of these compounds, the peptides within the protein, can inhibit cholesterol synthesis in the liver, that it may impair cholesterol absorption from foods, and that it can displace other unhealthy foods in our diet. Research has also shown that it can reduce arterial stiffness and improve endothelial function. However, there's conflicting evidence, so not all research is actually showing that it exerts its cardiovascular health benefits. Why is that? Well, so one of the primary compounds, so there's three isoflavones. These are phytochemicals. They're structurally similar to estrogen, which is up here in this box over here. But daidzine is one that needs to be converted to EPO, which is a metabolite. It's a metabolite produced from metabolism in your body. Specifically, it's converted to this by your gut microbiota. So we actually rely on these gut microbiota to help us digest and absorb certain nutrients. Well, it turns out that only 20-35% of U.S. adults are able to produce this metabolite. In China, where they consume soy foods a lot more, they're much more capable of producing this. So research has shown that the cardiovascular effects of soy are in people that are able to produce EPO as well as those that are unable to produce it, but that the effects are greater in those that are capable of producing this metabolite. There are a few other health claims approved by the FDA. So diets rich in fruits, vegetables, and grain products that contain soluble fiber can reduce the risk of coronary heart disease. Consumption of soluble fiber from certain foods can reduce the risk of coronary heart disease. heart disease, plant cereals can reduce the risk of heart disease, whole grains, heart disease, potassium, high blood pressure, and stroke. Just to switch gears a little bit to berries, this is an area that I've done some research in, and I think is fascinating, of course. So, berries, we all know berries are commonly consumed fruit in the United States, especially blackberries, raspberries, strawberries, blueberries. But there are also these other berries, like acai, aronia berries, blackcurrant, etc. These tend to be pretty low in calories, but very nutrient dense, so they have dietary fiber, vitamins, minerals, and a wealth of polyphenols, as you can see from their vibrant color. And numerous studies in cells, animals, humans, and epidemiological research is showing that they're very cardioprotective. So blueberries specifically contain numerous vitamins and minerals, vitamins A, C, folate, potassium, but they also contain polyphenols, such as flavonoids, phenolic acids, these are definitely a promising functional food for cardiovascular health, and currently research is showing that they tend to improve arterial stiffness and endothelial function. You can, there is some research that's shown that a single dose of blueberries can exert some of these cardiovascular protective effects, but also very long-term or chronic, so at least 8 weeks seems to be what's needed to have these cardiovascular protective effects, and the mechanisms through which they work in a single dose versus a chronic dosing regimen is a little bit different. So some examples of this. So one researcher, or one group of researchers in Oklahoma, showed that 50 grams of a freeze-dried blueberry powder, this is equivalent to about 2 cups of fresh blueberries a day, improved systolic blood pressure, the top number of the blood pressure reading, as well as diastolic blood pressure and markers of oxidative stress, specifically the lipids within our cells, in obese men and women with metabolic syndrome. And this was a middle-aged population, about 47 to 53 years old. We did a study when I was at Florida State, where we looked at the consumption of 22 grams, and this is equivalent to about a cup per day. And we found in postmenopausal women with elevated blood pressure that they had a reduction in blood pressure, in arterial stiffness, as well as increased nitric oxide metabolites. And nitric oxide is a molecule that's produced by the vasculature to cause your arteries to be able to expand or vasodilation. Interestingly, a couple of other studies did not find such an improvement in cardiovascular health. One did find improvements in endothelial function, but did not see reductions in blood pressure. That was a 6-week study. Another one for 6 weeks was in healthy young to middle-aged men. They found zero effect on endothelial function. Well, it turned out that these people had normal cardiovascular health at baseline, so there wasn't really any proof there. And this population was a little bit younger and didn't really have elevated blood pressure. So when I sort of get into interpreting research findings and what you see in the media and stuff like that, I think it's important for people to consider that certain factors in the study can kind of lead to these effects. So if they didn't have an impairment at baseline, it's like taking Advil for a headache that doesn't exist, right? Are you going to improve something that's not there? Potential role of the gut microbiota. And so even with Dr. Gentile over here in the audience, we're trying to pursue some funding to look at the role of the gut microbiota, and it may be that there's this very specific chronic intervention time frame that's needed to exert these beneficial effects. And interestingly, in human studies, blueberries have not been shown to improve lipid metabolism. So they do not reduce cholesterol levels based on the current evidence. Strawberries, on the other hand, strongly influence lipid metabolism. And so it seems here that the most promising effects are related to blood lipids, so cholesterol levels, for example, oxidative stress and inflammation, these very atherogenic molecules. So some examples here, 50 grams of strawberry powder reduced total and LDL cholesterol, but it has zero effect on blood pressure in middle-aged and older adults with metabolic syndrome. They also attenuated adverse effects to a high-fat meal. So when they fed strawberries with a meal, they saw that the strawberries reduced the sort of exacerbated elevation in blood lipids after the meal. We did a study, again, when I was at FSU, same population as our blueberry study. And interestingly, strawberries did not improve blood pressure, did not improve arterial stiffness. There was a very modest effect, but it was not anything like what we observed in our blueberry study. And so it sort of leads me to believe that these different foods, potentially through the different compounds that they contain, work differently to exert these cardiovascular health benefits. So would the effects when you combine these be greater? And I think that's important to think about when we're thinking about our diet and food. I mean, if we could just eat one food every day and live off of that and be healthy, then we wouldn't have to eat anything else, right? So that would not be very fun. But I think you guys get the point. So this one is just to sort of show you the influence of disease state and sort of this repeated exposure. And by repeated exposure, I mean having something more than once, so eating it every day, for example. So an interesting pilot study, and this is sort of some emerging research, they found that 10 days of consuming grape polyphenols by either lean individuals or those that were overweight or obese, the lean individuals had greater circulating metabolites following the 10-day exposure than their overweight or obese counterparts, suggesting that they had improved bioavailability of these compounds. Could be related to the gut microbiota. Zucker diabetic fatty rats had lower circulating and brain concentrations, and I didn't want to get too much into the animal research, but I thought it was kind of cool. So they had less of these polyphenols and metabolites that were actually able to get into circulation, get to brain, than their lean control rats. So this suggests that certain food states may influence the bioavailability and therefore the efficacy of these foods. So the research is still young in this area. As I said, it's an emerging area. But it suggests that liver function could be impaired. So sometimes we have fat accumulation in our liver that may affect the function. We may have alterations in our metabolizing systems, including the gut microbiota. We have, for example, with type 2 diabetes, with chronic kidney disease, we may have increased filtration of our blood into the kidneys, so increased clearance. We're able to get these out of our bloodstream quicker, as well as chronic inflammation can all impact disease. So, back to superfoods, because everybody, I'm sure, has heard of a superfood, right? Superfoods don't exist. So what makes a superfood super? Well, superfoods do not exist. They are a marketing term created by marketers, the media, and I'm not going to get into the fake news or anything. I'll relieve you from that. But they're not super, but they can be functional. So garlic cannot fly. You cannot eat a poor diet and consume these superfoods and expect that you're going to be protected against chronic disease, right? They're not that superfoods. But they can be functional. And consuming too much of any one food, so just because blueberries are good for you does not mean that you should eat like 2 pounds a day. You are going to be in the bathroom. It's not good for you. So basically, too much of one food or too few foods can also prevent you from getting certain nutrients because you're just focusing on this one food and not having enough of these other foods. Or it can lead to overconsumption. So wine can potentially be good for you. Doesn't mean a bottle every night is gonna prevent heart disease, right? It can actually cause it, or if you have too much chocolate, it might be. So why is nutrition science so controversial and confusing? So part of, you know, this talk today is just to introduce you to functional foods, to show you that they can have these cardiovascular health benefits. But I think we've all have seen something where one day they say it's good for you, the next day it's not good for you. Well, part of that is the fact that sometimes findings can be exaggerated, they can be misinterpreted. Sometimes you just want somebody to click on your post, right? Isn't that like a thing that journalists do when they pull stuff online? They want to see how many clicks they can get. So the more sexy it is, the more likely somebody is going to click on it. Studies don't often apply to populations that weren't studied. So if I study a healthy population, it doesn't mean that I can extend those findings to people with chronic disease. The health effects of foods and diet in general in humans, when we're doing research studies, the studies tend to be pretty short in duration unless you have a ton of money to follow them for several years. And so it might be hard to capture the health effects in that duration of time. Methodology differs, so there's different ways of conducting your research and collecting your data and analyzing your data, and that can all influence that as well. And we can't control everything, so humans are not easy to control. So if I ask you not to change your diet, doesn't mean you're not going to change your diet, and then I have to take your word for it. So that can create some variability as well. So these are some controversial foods. I'm sure you guys have heard recently, and that's sort of why I put that picture here. So the Time, the front of Time magazine in the 80s, cholesterol, fat was the devil, right? It was like awful for you. And now more recently, 2014, eat butter. What were we thinking? So good for you. So they sort of took something and exaggerated it and, right, and probably made people want to read this magazine. But this is sort of some of the stuff that creates confusion. So coconut oil is one of those. It's like a very hot food. It's, you know, coconut water is good for sports, endurance, and all of that stuff, which is probably true. But coconut oil is still loaded with saturated fat. And I'm not saying that it's not good for you, but right now we know that too much saturated fat isn't good for you. Coconut oil has a lot of it, therefore it could be bad for you. And I love coconuts, so I'm sad about that too. But right now, basically, based on this review, this is an interesting review that came out recently, kind of talking about some of these controversies. There's just no evidence to support that it's good for you, so we can't conclusively say that it's okay to have eggs. Eggs still can increase cholesterol, especially if your diet, if you're genetically prone to it. So some people just sort of took a snippet from the dietary guidelines and said eggs are good for you and ran with it, and they are good for you, but too much of anything is not good for you. Juicing can remove the dietary fiber, which is important. It can concentrate the calories and the sugar and make it not so good for you anymore. Gluten-free foods, there's no evidence either way. So on the left, there's evidence of harm. In the middle, there's inconclusive evidence. It doesn't mean that it's good or bad. It just means we don't have enough evidence at the time. So high-dose antioxidant supplements, probably not as good for you as eating whole foods. Extra virgin olive oil, we know, based on the evidence, that's good for you. Blueberries. Blueberries good for you, but not too much. Blueberries and strawberries. 30 gram serving of nuts per day, but portion control is needed because they're high in calories. Green leafy vegetables and plant-based proteins. Those have strong scientific evidence supporting cardiovascular health benefits. And I think it's important for us to have realistic expectations too. So when I present my research, sometimes people say, well, a 7 millimeter of mercury reduction in blood pressure doesn't really seem like a lot. Shouldn't it drop it by 20 or whatever? And I'm like, well, it's a food. You know, what do you expect from a single food? It's not a super food. So sometimes the effects may be modest, but you have to remember it's just a food. Functional foods may affect multiple tissues, so it may not just have a strong effect on one tissue, it can have small beneficial effects on multiple tissues. functional foods may not be effective in all contexts, and I think that that's okay. So, you know, I can get sad that strawberries didn't reduce blood pressure, or I can think about it like, well, they have these other benefits, and these other foods have these benefits, and why don't we put them all together and see if that's better? It's more of a comprehensive thing. And I like this quote here by Aristotle, the whole may be greater than the sum of its parts. So we have to think that you're not eating any food in isolation, you're eating it in the context of your overall diet. And so when we think about it that way, the effects can be greater in the context of a healthy dietary pattern. So the bottom line is that the future of our global population, the healthcare global population, is dependent on us shifting to a healthier dietary pattern. Small shifts can be achieved through the incorporation of nutrient-dense foods, which can be incorporated into a meal, into a day, into a week, into a month, etc. Specific foods can have very specific health benefits and can be incorporated into the diet to achieve these health benefits. So if you have high blood pressure, you can incorporate foods such as blueberries or beets or watermelon that have been shown to exert antihypertensive effects, and that may have an extra functional effect for you. I think it's important to consider the influence of factors in our health, in the environment, the food, etc., that may influence their functional properties, but don't let that discourage you from consuming them. No single food is super, and all foods have different arrays and amounts and types of these bioactive compounds that are very likely working together. And so variety is the key. So just quickly, putting on my dietitian hat, so some tips for incorporating some foods into your diet. So if you need more beta-carotene or want more beta-carotene, sweet potatoes can be substituted for regular fries. You can slice them, cook them in olive oil, bake them in the oven for 10 to 15 minutes. Lycopene, bioavailability can be improved by cooking and adding olive oil. Or you can eat watermelon. Do it soon before it goes on. Try whole grain breads and pastas. Some people don't like the whole grain flavor. Well, some are stronger than others. Beans, apples, citrus fruits, they all have soluble fiber. You can put them in numerous foods, such as a salad, an easy way to incorporate them into your diet. Make your own mixed nuts, such as almonds and walnuts, and add in some dried fruit to go with you. So something that you have, something that's easy. Add berries to your yogurt in the morning. You can add extra virgin olive oil to your vegetables to add flavor and to get any more olive oil, etc. And that concludes my presentation. Does change some of the compounds and the composition and the amounts, but some research, there's not a lot of research in this area yet in humans, but a lot of it is showing that even though it does have small changes in the types and amounts, it actually still has the same cardiovascular benefits when given in keto foods. And the reason that we use that for our research studies, it's a little less applicable to the real world, you know, because we don't need dried blueberry powder, we eat blueberries, right? And so there's some variability there in the compounds and how it's stored and those types of things, but for research purposes, we'll keep the compounds, and we know exactly what we're giving. So it's a little bit easier to see the effects. But we recently finished up a study with fresh pears. So we had to use two different types of pears due to the seasonality. There were issues with ripening and storage, and you know, so who knows if we had a different form of pears, what the results would look like. The results were modest on cardiometabolic health, but I think the fact that we had those issues is one of the strongest aspects of our study, because it's more applicable to what people are actually using and the real world challenges.
So I'm curious about freeze dry versus just using like a dehydrator. I mean, if you freeze dry, do you just like lay things out in a cookie sheet in your freezer and freeze them till they're dry, or how does that work?
They need some expensive equipment to do that. I don't have.
So do you know how it compares to just like a dehydrator that has the layers?
I think it's more quickly, it's like flash frozen.
Yeah. So probably like better nutritionally.
So it sort of preserves the nutrients a little bit better. It's been shown to retain nutrients better than other types of preservative methods.
Would almond milk with added calcium be considered a functional? Like, is there any difference in bioavailability
of calcium? Well, I suppose it depends. So like calcium and iron can compete for absorption. I don't think that there's an iron in almond milk. I don't actually know. I would think that it would still be absorbed the same.
So are we finding that as the food system has become more hybrid-based, that there's less bioavailability or fewer functionalities of the foods versus the, you know, the varietals and the things that we find to be produced? Is the whole production system screwing up some of the functionality of foods?
I think that it can have some sort of an influence, but
nobody's really looked at like a hybrid tomato versus, say, a varietal tomato. And
a lot of those studies are done in like cell models, and they kind of they'll look at the bioactive compounds within the hybrid tomato versus another type of tomato, and then do a cell study to show that it has antioxidant effects, but that doesn't always translate to humans, so I can't fully say that. Hoping that the USDA will start funding more research studies that test that sort of thing, because I think it's important to not just look at foods in the context of eating them, but we need to look at the influence of the farm to table, you know, continuum on that.
I have a question about your broccoli, the broccoli. Talk about how that enzyme gets destroyed when blending for everything. Do you know if that study looked at any form of heat or cooking on broccoli, or is this blanching the water, or would like roasted broccoli or any broccoli that's cooked then destroy that enzyme? Or would it
I think it could, and I think that's one of the benefits of not cooking it to death.
Yeah.
So, like when I grew up, I would gag when I ate broccoli because my mom would just like boil it, and I don't know what it turned into, but it wasn't broccoli. And it just smelled and tasted awful, and I think a lot of nutrients were not in there anymore. So, definitely.
I'm aware of the time, and I know that people have other commitments, so I'm going to go ahead and end this now. Please stay, talk to Sarah or Dr. Johnson if you'd like to, or mingle with each other, but for those of you who need to know to go, I know.